those of you who wonder why I sit here, I had a knee replacement not too long ago, and I'm, though a lot better, I find that this is a real nice place to sit while I preach, like a good rabbi sitting and speaking to his disciples, to his congregation, to those who bear listening to him. Today, in our first lesson, Ezekiel talks about setting a sentinel, a watchman, who is to watch. I suppose the whole idea is that you're in a city or a town or a country that is about to be invaded, about to be attacked, and the watchman is to watch so that everybody is prepared. It could be a watchman that is watching the satellites and making the predictions of where a hurricane is going to hit and what kind of things need to be done and when and how soon and how quickly. Or a watchman that is watching the seismograph and seeing that a big earthquake might be soon to happen. Not here, of course, but we have a good chance of that kind of thing happening here with the kind of disasters that we have seen in Mexico City, the earthquake just off the coast there that caused so much damage and destruction, and then the hurricane that filled the place with water afterwards. We can see how lucky we are to be here, although there's always the threat that we too will have some disaster strike us. Our neighbor's house burned down 7 or so months ago, and it almost set the forest on fire. The fire department came, and they couldn't save the house, but they did keep the forest from catching. You can see how many trees were really scorched, and it wouldn't have taken much to set that whole place ablaze. And we live in a cedar grove. We are in danger. All the time we have these anxieties and these things hanging over our head. The watchman is one who is careful and pays attention to what's going on around, not only for an enemy, but for potential disaster. I'm reminded of the watchman as the times when I was on watch on merchant ship. When I was on the school ship, on my first cruise, I was assigned at the first part of the cruise as a lookout. Now the lookout in those days stood up on the bow with a great big bell behind him, great big bronze bell. And if you saw something on the starboard side, you'd give it a ring. If you saw it on the port side, you'd give it 2 rings. And if you saw it dead ahead, you'd give it 3 rings. And then the bridge would take a look. Of course, the bridge has the radar going, and they probably saw the ship or whatever it is that you're sighting long before you do, and just waiting to see how soon you would notice it, or if you were asleep up there on the bow. It was too cold to sleep. It was freezing cold. Coming out of San Francisco, waves breaking over everything, and it was just nasty as could be. And coming down the coast to Los Angeles Harbor, where we fueled for a trip down to South America. This was a big ship. It was an ex-military attack transport. So it had big cargo gear on it. It had room for lots of people. And it was a great school ship for the California Maritime Academy where I was attending. One of the things that we had on this ship was old Navy stuff. We didn't have the communication that a new ship would have today. The lookout would not be on the bow probably today anymore. And the lookout didn't have to be back aft either when the ship was being maneuvered, because now they have a television camera like many of your cars have to see where you're backing up to, whether you're far enough away from the dock or not. But in this case, when we sailed out of San Pedro after fueling, I was on the bridge. We sailed out in the evening. It was nighttime by the time we got to the breakwater. I was on the bridge wing, way out on the edge, on the starboard side. And this is an area that I sailed on all through high school. I had a sailboat down in this harbor. And I sailed all around and up and down the coast and over to the Catalina Island on a little 23-foot open star sailboat. Starboat. Great big mast, lots and lots of sail. No reef points. No engine. No radio. And, but I was, so anyway, it was my, that's another whole story. But this time I was on watch, and I was up there, and to report anything that I saw, anything that might be of danger to the ship. And as soon as it got dark, I saw two torpedoes coming straight for the bow. You see the fluorescence in the water, these streams, and I should have reported it, right? But I was terrified, and I figured it didn't make any difference if I reported it or not. We were going to be blown to smithereens in just a few minutes. And as soon as the torpedoes got to the bow, they turned and jumped out of the water and swam along with us, two dolphins. And if I had reported it, can you imagine what I had been called all the time I was at the academy? Torpedo cannon, or here come the torpedoes, or whatever. So, on watch. You have to be discerning, and you have to be cautious, and you have to use some sense. Don't just scream at everything that you think is going to be a danger. Think about it. Is it really a danger? Is there anything I can do about it? Is there anything we can do about it? And then do what needs to be done, which may be quiet. Dangers not only of physical things, but dangers in relationships. Our gospel story today talks about relationships going sour. It's talking about someone in church. This is one of the hardest texts to preach on because Jesus did not say these things. We can tell by the text itself that Jesus, and I'll show you where, Jesus would not have said these, could not have said these things. Now, they're not, that doesn't mean that they're not the right thing to do. But they're not the words from Jesus' mouth. Matthew had a Jewish congregation that he was, a Jewish people that he was writing his gospel for, as opposed to our epistle, which was Paul, who though didn't write what we call a gospel, wrote the book to the Romans, the epistle to the Romans, which is his gospel. His whole message about God and the world and us and Christ and what we need to do about it. Matthew is writing to the Jews. There was conflict between the missions to the Gentiles and the missions to the Jews. The Jews thought everybody should become Jewish Christians. Everybody should be circumcised. And they were called the circumcision party, or by Paul, but not necessarily by themselves. But they believed that everybody should go through the act and become a Jewish Christian. He says, we want, and they're having some conflict, not only between these different factions within Christendom, but within the congregations themselves. There's not everybody that would feel the same way as Matthew did. Just like there's not everybody that agrees with everything that is going on in the churches today or in this congregation today. We have differences. We believe we're different. We believe differently in our politics. We believe differently in our social issues. But we get along with each other. And we get along with each other, as Paul says, by loving each other. That love is the fulfillment of the law. Love God and love your neighbor as yourself. I've talked quite often about how we're supposed to love our neighbor and love our enemies, quoting Jesus. Loving our enemies. People have asked me, how can I love my enemy? There's some people out there that I just can't stand, that I just really hate, and I can get caught up in that. And you can get caught up in that, and that can tear you apart. Jesus doesn't want you to be that way. God doesn't want you to be torn apart. He wants you to forgive your enemies. He wants you to love them as you love yourself. He wants you to forgive yourself as well. Forgive yourself, and then you can forgive your enemy, then you can love your enemy as you love yourself, as you love your neighbor. Love is the fulfillment of the law, Paul says. Now Jesus would not have said that. You know, Paul, Matthew is going on and he says, you know, if they don't agree with you, tell it to everybody. Tell it to the church. And what's the church? How are you going to tell it to the church? In a congregation meeting? In a sermon? Write it out in the bulletin or have the council do something about it? How do we as a church make a decision and do something about anything that we disagree on or we disagree with, even a little bit? It's not that easy. Or in a family, how do you, in a family, I was a family counselor for many years, how do you deal with conflict within the family? They can't do it with themselves, they come to a counselor. And most of the time, we can't do it that way either. by the time they come to me, they are ready for a divorce and they just want to go through the motions so that they can have a clear conscience about getting a divorce. And most of the time, what I wanted to do is try to keep them from fighting with each other, from hating each other, from carrying that around. And if there's children involved, even more so. These small neighbors that we live with. What do we do if we can't love them? If we can't love them, are we to be like Gentiles and Pharisees? Those were Jesus' best friends. He said they would go to heaven before the Pharisees did, the self-righteous, the people that the religious leaders that could not see the speck in their own eye, the mote or the log in their own eye, but only this little speck in the neighbors, in the enemies. All of Jesus' parables, almost all of them, are about this reconciliation, getting it together with your neighbor, with the person that needs it. And who is the neighbor in many of his parables? It's the enemy, the good Samaritan, the Samaritans, the Gentiles. So, we have a gospel lesson that Jesus probably didn't say, but probably was needed in the church. And the messages that it presents are probably needed in our society somehow or another. But who's going to be the judge? Who's going to be the judge? One person says, I've been sinned against, I've been hurt by this other person. The other person may have something to say too. And in our lesson, the other person has no representation. There's no due process. He's taken to these groups that are probably hostile toward him. The other person in the church, the people in the congregation, and he has no chance of defending himself except by himself. And perhaps everything he says is just going to be held against him and make it worse. How do we deal with that kind of a situation if we can't deal with it by love? If we can't deal with it, and we don't mean by love by kissy-kissy love or sexual love or anything like that. We're talking about agape, the self-giving love. The love that we see in Christ in dying to save us. This, the love that, of God that's self-sacrificing. We are to do that, be that kind of love. We just have this one word that describes three or four different kinds of action. If we just called it agape, then we wouldn't get too confused about it. How can we agape our enemy? This sounds a lot different than how could we love our enemy. How can, that's the Greek word. And as you know, this all was written in Greek, the Bible, originally. Maybe originally in Aramaic, but that's not something that not very many of us know. But all of the texts that we have surviving, the ones that come from even the earliest times, are all in Greek, or in a variation of it. So, here we are, a congregation listening to this gospel about Jesus that Jesus probably didn't write or didn't say, but about something that we need, something that we need to know. And we need to know that this is the truth in a way. The only untruth is that it's being said by Jesus. So I hand it to you. Where do you go from there? How do you agape yourself, your neighbor, your enemy? Well, what are the things you can do besides loving him? The things that Paul says, you can pray for him. Pray without ceasing. Pray all the time for those people that are being devoured by the hurricane or by the earthquake. Pray for them. Give for their relief if you can. But the thing that you can do is pray. Everyone can do that. It won't cost you anything. It will enrich you. And it may do some good. Our little saying in the blurb that you have, bulletin insert, is about that. Thank God that God didn't give me everything I wanted, but maybe gave me what I needed. Amen.